their impetus, they could stay sober on their own if they wanted to. Now, a lot of these folks gravitate to AA because we have something here that they've never had. We've got love and a fellowship and all kinds of stuff going on all the time, and people care. It's a wonderful place to be. So as we think about our role as sponsors, let's think of ourselves as teachers. If you don't like that word, instructor, or someone who is sharing his or her experience, strength, and hope in the way of actually demonstrating through words and deeds how the steps are worked. You call it whatever you want. Bill calls it teaching. And I like that word because it describes, as far as I'm concerned, exactly what the role of the sponsor is. From now on, at any time, if you've got questions or wish to make comments or share anything, please feel free to do it. We don't have any rules here. We got a lot of material to go through in 35 or 38 weeks, but we've always got time for questions and clarify stuff, so please feel free to do that. Or if you feel the urge to share something that you know is appropriate to what we're talking about, please. I don't care, you know, if it, sometimes we get sidetracked for half an hour or so, and it's not a problem. We got plenty of time. That's the beautiful thing about doing this workshop, guys, is that it's our baby. We do it as we please. I'm not talking about me, I'm talking about you and me. And we're doing this for the purpose of learning and helping ourselves to do our steps better and also to become more efficient and more knowledgeable sponsors. Also, it gives us a certain degree of courage, you know, to pick up sponsorship. If we haven't done it before, we feel that we have a real message to carry, and in fact, we do. Now then, let's think some more about this business of sponsorship, and let's see how it developed. And all of these things are absolutely critical to us. It always amazes me every time I think back and share the history of how this all got started, and I think of all of the things that had to happen exactly as they did, and the time that they did, and in the way that they happened, or we wouldn't be here. I've been dead a long, long, long time ago. Maybe some of you would be too. When Bill came out of the hospital, and he had decided that he was going to have to carry this message that he'd been given. And can you imagine now? He went home, talked to Lois, and he said, in effect, Lois, this thought has come to me, and Abby has backed me up in this, that there are thousands of alcoholics out there that need what I've been given, and I'm going to have to do my best to carry that message out there to him. And he asked her if she would support him in this. Now, I suppose the average wife, having suffered through 25 years of alcoholism and all the crapped out behavior, would say, Bill, you're sober now. I put up with enough of your nonsense. You don't move from this house without my permission. And you can start by carrying out the garbage. But she didn't say that at all. She said, yes, Bill, I will support you in that. I believe in that. And she did for the rest of his life. And even after he was gone, she carried on the work. Now keep in mind that was through thick and thin, and boy, it was thin part of the time. You know that there was a time when Bill and Bob were so broke that they finally begged some money out of the Rockefeller people, and they came up with $5,000. They took $3,500 of those dollars and paid off Dr. Bob's mortgage, and Bill and his wife were able to live on the other $1,500 for a considerable period of time. It went a long way in the 30s. And then eventually they were granted royalties from the sale of the Big Book. And for a long time, they lived on those royalties. Bill and his wife lost their house. It was foreclosed right out from under him. And he never really had gainful employment after that. Once in a while, he'd do some brokerage work here and there. But Bill got so was so busy out there writing and speaking and traveling, and he and Lois traveled in all over the world, you know. And he just carried the message. Just stop and think. Suppose Bill had gotten sober and said, "That's it, man. I can attack my profession. I can go back to Wall Street. I can start making lots of money, and life will be wonderful. And I'll get my golf course tan back, and I'll have enough money. I can go back on the country club, and all my friends will." But he didn't do that. I think it's quite clear that Bill was touched by God. I think it's quite clear that when Bill got down on his knees and asked God to show himself, that when Bill had his epiphany, it was such a massive spiritual experience that he really never got over it. It was something that just stayed with him, and I believe that it motivated him to do what he did. Well, after Lois had said yes, she would support him, Bill went out, and you remember it was for 6 months trying to get anybody to follow him, to even listen to him. Oh, he'd find these drunks, and they'd be glad to come to his house, find a place to plop out for a couple of days and get something to eat, and they'd work him for a few bucks that he might have. A couple of them tried to burn his house down. There's all sorts of stuff going on there. And Lois put up with all this nonsense, by the way. But nobody got sober. And Bill went to Dr. Silkworth, and Bill was in terror. He didn't know what was wrong here. What am I doing wrong, Doc? Well, Dr. Silkworth had learned a lot of lessons with Bill, and probably the biggest lesson he learned was that when Bill was in his hospital for the second time, back in I believe it was in 33, maybe early 34. When he was being discharged, Dr. Silkworth said to Bill and to his wife, "Look here, there's nothing more I can do for you. You're a hopeless, helpless, chronic alcoholic. You have a disease which is incurable and progressive, and I hate to tell you this, Bill, but it is invariably fatal, and you're going to die. If you don't stop drinking, I don't think you can make it for another year." Well, Silkworth remembered what he had said to Bill at that time, and then he put two and two together, and he said, "This is what must have happened. Something got through to Bill when I told him that. Because when Ebby came to him, and Ebby was sober, and Ebby was carrying the message to him, Bill actually listened. And Bill realized, as he says in his story three or four different times, that he was licked, that he was whipped, that alcohol was his master. And when Ebby asked him if he would have what he, Ebby, had, and Bill writes, "Would I have it? Of course I would." So Dr. Silkworth put this all together, and he said, "You know, one of the things we have to do, Bill, that I've learned from your experience, and I'm going to teach it to you. The alcoholic has to know what's wrong with him. You got to hit him over the head. It's got to be a sledgehammer blow. You got to drive the point home. But you have a disease, and it is incurable, and it is invariably fatal, and it is progressive." He said, "Also, Bill, I want to tell you that I've watched what you're doing, and I know that you're making a terrible mistake because you are spiritually arrogant. You're thinking that everybody out there ought to have one of those massive epiphanies, those burning bush experience just like yours. And so you're spending the first precious moments with the new person recounting your experience with God." He said, "That can't be anything more or less than a terrible mistake. You're coming from some religious spiritual Mount Olympus. And of course, Bill recounted later the one, he'd go into a bar and see some guy there. He'd seen him there off and on for a while. He knew he was a drunk. He'd come up to him and say, "Man, you're an alcoholic. You know, you're a drunk." "Well, what do you want?" "Well, I'm going to help you get sober." "Well, what do I got to do?" "Get down on your knees and start praying." "Well, hit your knees, sucker." And that just didn't work, of course. So Silkworth said, "Bill, you're going to have to change your entire way of going about this." Now, what Dr. Silkworth taught Bill at that time is now memorialized in Chapter 7. The first 7 or 8 pages of Chapter 7 follow almost precisely the formula that Dr. Silkworth gave Bill all the way back there in early 1935, prior to Bill's trip to Akron. Bill took it to heart. He didn't have any other opportunity to try it out until he got to Akron. And there he ran into a boatload of trouble. He was there on business. The business failed miserably. You can see Bill on the night, that first night, and he's back from this failure of his business opportunity. His money's about gone. And he comes into the hotel. And off to his right, he sees the bar, and everybody's in there tinkling the glasses with the ice in the glass and laughing and having a gay old time. And he says to himself, "Man, that's what I ought to be doing. The heck with all of this nonsense." He remembered something, however, which was that if he did not want to drink, he was going to have to find some way to talk to another alcoholic to carry the message that that was the one hope he had. Now, right in front of Bill was a board about the size, there are pictures of it, it's still there today. And it was a directory of churches in the area. And Bill looked at that directory of churches and he thought, "Well, maybe I can find a minister who's got a prospect, a rip-roaring drunk that nobody can handle. Let me see if I can find out." He took one name, one phone number at random from that board, dropped a nickel in the slot, called, the minister was there. Bill explained to him what he was doing and what he was looking for, and the guy says, "Well, I know somebody who can maybe help you." Turned out this minister was very well acquainted, a friend of Henrietta Seeberling, who was the heiress to the Seeberling tire fortune. And he gave Bill Henrietta's phone number. And she was a compassionate lady, a great lady. And Bill called her, and he explained to her that he needed to find himself an alcoholic that he could help, because otherwise he was going to drink. And she said, "I think I got just the prospect for you." Turned out that Henrietta was a friend of Dr. Bob's. Now just stop and think what all this stuff had to come together right at this right time, just before Bill was going to blow it all and we wouldn't be here. There'd be no AA today. I'm convinced of that. And there was the minister, and there was Henrietta, and then there was Dr. Bob, and Bill had just been with Dr. Silkworth, so now he knew what he was supposed to do. He met Dr. Bob, and here's what he did. First, he sat down and he got to know Dr. Bob a little bit, asked him quite a bit about himself. Then, without making any judgments, without saying, "Well, I hear, you know, around town that you're really town drunk, you know, you must be an alcoholic, and you know, quit denying it, you know, all that stuff." He didn't say anything like that. What he said was, "Let me tell you, Bob, how I drank." And so he told Dr. Bob how he drank. He told him about alcohol and how it affected him. He told him about trying to stop and not being able to. He told him about the four horsemen: terror, bewilderment, frustration, and despair. He told him about the angers, the rages, the resentments, the dishonesty, the overwhelming selfishness. Especially told him about the fears that he'd suffered. Fear that simply paralyzed him. And he couldn't stop. And especially he pounded on this that he tried over and over again to stop and hadn't been able to. But to now, he had a long term of sobriety and he'd found a way. They said, now first, Bob, what I want you to understand, I know you're a medical guy and you got all of this wonderful knowledge and you're a man of great spiritual content. I mean, this is what I hear, that you have far greater spiritual development than I have. But let me tell you what's wrong with you. You are an alcoholic and you have a disease. And I said, I know you didn't learn that in medical school, and no doctor out there is going to admit it because they don't know it. But it's the truth. You have a disease. And this disease means that you're one of those people like me whose body does not tolerate alcohol.